Today's date is the 19th of 2017. It is now 12:35 p.m., the day before Donald Trump's swearing in. Congratulations. I think you will be worth every minute of it. Ultimately, it's never about one man, if I should cite Ace of Base. No man is fit to rule the world to rule the world alone. I used to run around listening to that years ago. Anyway, when I could still jog. Anyhow, reason I'm recording this is my plight for continue to upholding, for instance, Mr. David Volz, if I pronounce it correctly, who is running around the United States right now raising awareness about psychotronics. My respect to you, sir. You're doing a good job for the Navy, or representing, per se. And the topic, I think you will appreciate if you get a chance to watch this. This is my response for the active debate for those that are being appointed and reviewed and confirmed for Donald Trump's administration. Most recently is because of Bernie Sanders' recent arguments with the Navy SEAL. I didn't care for what I heard, but I'm going to try to make a point relative to what you're doing walking around the United States right now. Bernie Sanders is, from what I'm reading, pretty much defending Barack Obamacare. Those that wrote Barack Obamacare, obviously, it was not Obama that wrote it. Now, from what I'm understanding, the where and how it came about started in it about 1999. Now, and this is where I will go with this, just as a point, in Iran, of all places on earth, in 2008, you can read on the National Health Institute Library, peer-reviewed library, there was an argument that came forward about dental amalgam mercury. And its argument was actually about the vapor release of dental amalgam. This is my tooth. I pulled it myself. It made 50% mercury. It, in theoretical points, concluded a number of issues, theoretically and hypothetically, of the Hitler phone bridge effect post-1941. And from the background concerns that supposedly the Allies went into, that they concerned themselves with when it came to psychotronics. More specifically, the induced tinnitus, thermal effect, vibration on the human flesh, creating varied degree of neuropsychosis, misdiagnosed, such as, and not limited to, the schizoaffective induced issues. And the relevancy for long period of time and its impact on cognitive function, develop cognitive function, and so on. Just as to make a reference, that was pretty much a leading conclusion from some of the material that I have read to Mr. Martin Paul, P-A-L-L, from Washington State University. From his work that I have read, his work did not seemingly surround the fact of dental amalgam. It was more on the non-ionizing radiation impacts and environment, which pretty much conclude the same theoretical points that would be around dental amalgam or medical devices and dental use of such, including gold. If I should cite the Hitler phone fringe effect, i.e. psychotronics. Now, there's a reason that I'm trying to highlight those points, and I will cite the Church Committee of 1975 that ended in 1978 or so, and it was supposed to have outlawed the uses, similar to it. It's pretty much been ignored. Here's a point. Bernie Sanders, as he was seemingly defending Barack Obamacare. Barack Obamacare, post the Telecommunications Act of 1996, Section 704, even in light of the very sorry excuse of an apology for those that have been experimented on as far back as the 1950s to the 1970s, that even was supposed to have been a background issue that led to the Church Committee for even the FBI's involvement and supposed watch groups for various different things, including this. Now, Bernie Sanders made an argument and was arguing with the Navy SEAL. He's got a right to say whatever he wants, same as the SEAL does. But that SEAL's got something in the back pocket that he and Bernie Sanders needs to be listening on. And that SEAL is exactly right when it comes to the backlogs issues and so on, and reference to what I'm understanding about the health effects and the wrong the and so on. More would be the vaccination issues. And I can say I can agree with everything that the man would say because I actually experienced it. It just about killed me. That was part of the reason that I was put out of the military. The second was because of the neuropsychiatric factors in joint with the vaccines and the amalgam factor. Interesting enough, and that was 1995. Now, Rand Paul has even made the same arguments when it comes to the debate about those when it says induced autism. And there was a case not too long ago here in Bloomington, Indiana, where there was a doctor that actually made a significant SEAL-type case and was settled for millions of dollars for induced cases. And I believe his was post-pregnancy. And I believe some of the background from some of the details I've read to the research would line up with even Rand Paul's announcement, and for one of the reasons seemingly why he, as I understood, as a suggestion of why he didn't allow his own kids to get the numerous shots at once because of the concern of the probability of what happened of the multiple chemical sensitivity reactions and shock, given the nature of the concern of the consistency makeup of the vaccines, and what would be amount to equivalent to the fluoride debate of the Tsukujimitsu effect, and that's a form of self-induced embalming as the body would be going into shock and your organs shutting down and the effects of what that can do. There's only one factor that seems to be left out in that debate, which even though that there are numerous cases in courts that have actually proved the fact that they know it does induce brain damage. And that would be from what I have read or come to learn to understand from the White Men Fear to Tread book, the life biography of the late Mr. Russell Means of the Native American movement, or American Indian movement, excuse me, where he seemingly cited a question for a point when he was arguing he didn't want his kids to get the silver nitrate eye drops. There we go. I can get it out. And the concern, from what I read of the background, led me to the joint argument of what I had read through even Rand Paul's, or seen or heard of him, even in his own work as an eye doctor. And that is, at the point of birth, getting the silver trade eye drops, and the salt solution, thimisol argument debate, because it is a known fact there, it is incompatible with the vaccine in proximity debate and thimisol. It was supposed to be one of the reasons they actually stopped the physical use because of it. So I'll have to give that argument there as a point. As I understand, Mr. Russell means the reason he didn't want it, because obviously I think the man did his homework, but as I understand the point in reverence Mr. Russell means was making, because he felt that it was an insult that they suggested, or it was a mandate that his kids get it because of suggesting that Native Americans were dirty, filthy, and it was venereal diseases. Venereal diseases can happen with anybody. But anyway, just as a reference, if I understand the book, it took me about 2.5 years to read that book. I recommend anybody read it, and they maybe understand exactly what I'm getting about if they do their homework. So as Bernie Sanders is arguing in defense of Barack Obamacare, there are numerous things that it could have addressed to be true reform that was completely ignored. The silver and eye drops is still a factor. The vaccine argument is even a humongous one over and beyond that. There are numerous points to prove a point that is inducing the medical factors, of which henceforth some of the legitimacy is seemingly based upon, to validate the point, to use it, which defeats the point of a doctor if the doctor's trying to prevent the disease and cause when they're actually using the mechanism that's causing it. First, do no harm. I think it was Meryl Streep that was in that movie. Interesting, I may have crossed the wrong one, but we'll stop there. The other one is the fluoride debate. Mankind over the years, if you look at the evolution of use of formula in milk versus breast milk, and using in the fluoride in the breast milk earlier, younger, and the combination of this Sukujibitsu effect or multi-chemical sensitivity factor, they are predisposing in from gestation to birth and post-vac. The earlier they're given to them, they're literally placating the forced eugenic sterilization euthanizational process by the nature of what they're using in population control theories historically. So if they were actually going to argue a point just on that, it would prove a point that Barack Obamacare, the ones that wrote it, really weren't interested in accomplishing too much. There really wasn't a significant true doctor's debate of what would be stopped using if they knew it would be stopped. The fluoride fact is a fact they know now beyond a shadow of a doubt because of Flint, Michigan is not the only one in the United States. Got it. It's nationwide. The Sukujibitsu effect, even Mrs. Erin Brockovich, could probably help validate if she was actually being there. Seems to me this person they're put in Health and Human Services, they should recommend her to be appointed for that, or the EPA or another ones, maybe even the FCC or the EPA for that fact, just to try to bring a point for those that are actually trying to argue it. Even this Mr. Robert Kennedy Jr. fellows in his Mercury debate argue is pretty much the exact same lining in the argument, where if I should cite Flint, Michigan, when the relevancy again is an environmental factor of toxicity being forced upon Americans, where if the fluoride was never legalized, it was seemingly created through a abusive admin law and so on, or even an act of martial law or an act of chemical attack from the infiltration of the Nazis themselves, that's literally been left to exist in the United States however it originated. Nonetheless, its chemical factors are inducing heavy metal by the flow through in corrosion factor, increasing the lead factor or heavy metal factor almost to the same regard in another form when it comes to what they know about when it comes to the amalgam debate. Where, as a point, so where true reform would have come, it doesn't exist. There is no legal, there's no argument for it there. And what makes it worse is that in 2013, the Mid-Atlantic Convention was passed or created, seemingly without a true Senate order, passed by Congress and so on and validated, as it should have, where John Kerry, as much as I disagree with a bunch of what the man says, my respect to one point, even though what he did was an executive fiat abuse, he actually was one of the first ones to acknowledge the Hitler phone bridge effect in another form by seemingly signing the Minamata Convention to stop the uses of the dental mercury amalgam, but yet didn't include it in it. The 9 orders that were assigned to it that they agreed for was never truly originated out of the Senate to be able to give a true consistency of what an agreement could be to start with that would be actually pliable, considering it circumvented of every origination of scientific argument with the scientific advisors and so on, not to mention the FDA considering what it was supposed to have been for. But yet the EPA seemingly was rent for, which just recently the EPA actually did something with it and supposedly is going to enforce the argument of health factor into the environmental factor for the same capacity with the Minamata Convention was historically when it came to the water debate and getting into the water supply and what it did then, and the very minute trace elements of fact proving a point. There's no safe level of mercury in the concentrations of what they argue. It gives them what they got when it came to the health debate, including the neuropsychiatric fallout, developmental problems, DNA defect, and so on. So, where the Senate, everybody complains Obama for one, or Senate for, or these agencies, these people, where they seemingly take order initiative, where's the Senate actually demanding the order be respected, the constitutional order of the petition, versus the uses of administrative law, if I should say Dr. Philip Hamburg might have been promising the same argument, where these things are created, but there's no follow-through whatsoever. There's the origination doesn't respect the represented republic. It placates the very mob democracy that was Nazi Germany, that seemingly they're allowing to exist and function as it is with what this argument is right now, literally. And the amalgam debate, or the medical device debate, is the worst of the two. Well, is almost as equal as the others because of the psychotronics factor, and that's a point. Now, in 2013, just what happens to be the FCC, in the same capacity, created an administrative agreement, and seemingly nobody ever checked anything out. The Notice of Inquiry, Docket 1384, Paragraph 205, is supposed to be a complete reevaluation for all non-ionizing emitters and frequencies. Seemingly a suggestion, from what I'm understanding, if I should cite Dr. Joel McClosewitz, who is a part of the Right to Know Law case or ordinance in California, where in 2012 or thereabouts, the Government Accounting Office, Accountability Office, made a suggestion that they need to. Now, I question how much of that is a continuing factor as what they knew, which Iran confirmed theoretically, which they have known since as far back as the Church Committee from going back to World War II. Now, I'm going to bring up a secondary. It seems to me if General Shelton was an argument when the light square debate was taking place when it came to frequency arguments. Now, most of what they were arguing with, from what I understand, obviously I wasn't in there, but as a point of security and a national security and so on, when it came to increasing the argument of what is going to be psychotronics, whether it be alone, if I should cite Dr. Paul Martin, or Mr. Martin Paul, P-A-L-L, if his work's an argument that's conclusion or conclusive and congruence with others that I'm reading that about those that have drawn the same conclusions about induced schizophrenia, which is not true schizophrenia, schizoaffective. The same symptomatology, if I cite, as I'm trying to reiterate, General Shelton when it comes to the history, if I should cite Air Force, Air Force Base Command, Air Corps prior to 1947, when it came to the Foo Fighters argument, before the first jets were even actually supposedly used in the capacity ability of what they were able to do. When it came to evaluation, when people talk about here's your tinfoil hat, well, part of the history, I'd love to actually see him testify in the upcoming FCC replacement for Tom Wheeler to actually go into the details of what that was. When it came to the neuropsychiatric induced, the thermal impact of variations and concerns, whether it was solely a neuropsychiatric as it's playing tricks on the eyes, eye proteins, and so on, the neurointerceptors of that argument, or the thermal effect vibrating on the human ear, vibrating the human flesh, the tinnitus, inducing a flight-fight response, an overcompensation as your brain is trying to deal with the multifaceted impact of trauma in a moment. When it came to PTSD evaluations from the Air Force, Army Air Corps, prior 1947, when the flight surgeons were supposedly doing the analysis that would have led to some of those conclusions, which is an active debate. So if I should look at those combinations when it comes to, if you actually want to talk about reform, or even compared to what that Navy SEAL was trying to say, versus what Bernie Sanders and them are trying to defend, Bernie Sanders is just as guilty as the rest of them when it comes to where they're ignoring their own job, even under advisement from some of the generals and stuff, because they're telling them to shut their mouth. So if the Metatonic Convention was created by executive fiat, nonetheless, at least John Kerry made an effort. The point is, where were the senators actually doing what they should have to say, hey, look, that's fine, you're going to go to Japan, you got this argument, you're going to come to us first. You're going to get your orders from us first. Then we're going to give you the orders, then you're going to say what you agree to. Because as it stands, the sentiment of the argument of the Minamata Convention alone is not enforced. The FDA's website does not update it. It claims it's an allergy when it comes to the dental amalgam, which is not true. Toxic heavy metal mercury, element mercury shock is, or like of the trauma of it, isn't, there's no safe level. It's not an allergy. Their label is wrong. The Minamata Convention was seemingly inceptions of it was to correct those factors. The FDA's website argues that it is a concern going in the tooth, it's an in concern coming out. And all actuality, they're absolutely correct. The only way to safely remove it, regardless of what evidence of harm group people, the people who wrote the movie that's got the New York Times Square big screen, if they're talking about safely moving, they're showing the mop suit. There's no way to safely remove it in that regard once it gets in. Should never be put in to start with. Removing it means removing the tooth. Or you're going to have to leave with, if you want your tooth, that means they're going to have to change the diagnostic factor, take into consideration of what they're dealing with. That means stop lying to the public. That means changing how, or making sure the doctors know how to evaluate the situation so they don't mistreat them for schizophrenia, bipolar, or any other neuropsychiatric disorder for a conclusion of what's supposed to be heavy metal poisoning. Or misconcluded the synergistic interreactions, if I should cite the Psychotronics effects, of what even Air Force Space Command history could probably be very well spoken to in the confirmation of arguments for the new FCC commissioner, the one that's now resigning as of December the 12th, I believe it was, of 2016. It just proves a point here that if the history of even what Air Force Space Command dealt with, even then before it became, when it even goes back to the scientific what-if factors of the black light or black night argument, when it came to even what's dictated, seemingly suggests, in private snafu booby traps 1944 signal cord training videos back when the OSS and Naval Intelligence and the rest of them were created, when they were looking all those same factors as they were learning and what they were learning from even Heidi Lamar and her interaction with Adolf Hitler and Mussolini, is when they were creating all that and the new inventions were coming into use in that same debate. They're sending the signals out. What's coming back? What's it going to affect? They've hidden it for years. From what I understand, that was one of supposed to be the exact reasons that they actually started using the fluoride. That's a big question from understanding that part of it. The rest of it, it seems to be, was almost a chemical attack. It works like Prozac because it kills the brain. It disrupts that flight, reasoning, fight response. It's a big question there. That is a fact. So there's two portions here of where Bernie Sanders is saying that Obamacare is worth something, and those that are continuing to defend it, they're leaving out some of the most significant things in history. And the fluoride fact is even now more of a fact in proving a point here that in Flint, Michigan, since 1941 to date, using it in the lead piping, they have increased the Sokochibitsu effect, heavy metal poisoning, which is now an argument in the federal or in the courts that the judges gave permission for them, for the people to sue. So now all those people for all those years that have experienced the what ifs of induced autism, savants, Asperger's, and so on, were even in the vaccine debate, the same thing is the what if. The concentration of the consistency of the environmental concerns at a young age is literally being overlooked. So this whole argument about Flint, Michigan, so Bernie Sanders actually wants to say that even though supposedly Congress passed this new bill they're going to do something with, they're not doing anything with it. They're still ignoring the fact of their own true power in the Senate to tell the agencies what to do, not let the agencies tell them what to do. I think that's beyond mob democracy, which they seemingly like to placate, versus the representative republic, where the republic and the representation tells the agency what to do, not vice versa. So, as we stand in the argument, as the Navy SEAL was seemingly trying to make his point, the Navy SEAL will be correct, absolutely correct. And it seems to be that as they're arguing about true reform and reevaluation, that would mean almost a complete redo by the Senate for a complete rehabilitation of infrastructure almost to the exact same scale of what would have occurred with the Marshall Plan at the end of World War II and rebuilding Europe in small sections across the United States as they relocate individuals out of the worst zones they can as they rebuild it. Imagine that, taking more time to concentrate in the United States than worry about who's doing what, where. Grant you, I know Islam is screwed up as it can get. They keep chewing on the fluoride sticks. That may answer a few questions. But yet, even in that capacity, if we're looking at the terrorism issue, those are arguing against Trump about trying to make sure the wall's secure. Let's cut to the chase. Those factors are a concern. Sleepers are a concern. The creation for sleepers, what was perceived as sleepers, but what is even the argument behind waterboarding, which they're lying about, which they're not told the truth about, is related specifically to psychotronics and the dental amalgam issue. Compounded worse today because of even the use of microchips or these rice implants that even that was supposed to have been eventually going to become a debate, if I should cite Joe Biden in the confirmation arguments of one of the Supreme Court justices years ago. When it came to the argument of the Fourth Amendment, this would supersede Fourth Amendment in some regards. This was actually, you know, the inundation of humanity cooking them slowly, if I should cite the work of Mr. Cherry Bower, the British physicist that I was reading about, who talks about microwave frequencies and so on. So that would highlight some of the same concerns for even what, when it comes to the whole point of what even Alex Jones suggests when it comes to red flags. You look at the Alto Sterling case or the Florida cases, how many of those interreactional points are similar to that same scenario? That's not a physical attack. You read these groups, say, where they're targeted by individuals and so on. The conception of the thought may seem like that to those that have it or feeling affected by it, by the hypersensitivity with or without the amalgam, of which Dr. Martin Paul of Washington State University would seem in his work as an analyzing point. How many of those cases, when it comes to the cognitive development over a period of time, then you add the impact of their personal lifestyle, you would have an argument of the debatable point of what the LSD trials would have been a conclusive for, some of which, similar to even the Muntuck, if I should cite Vietnam history, and the wandering souls in psychological warfare, from the same inundational concern of what sound and manipulation could do in another form versus what psychotronics can do in another existing form. If I should cite the operation or Project Muntuck and the time warp mental memory recall, brain injury and so on scenarios, that would have been the ultimate concern for the even the CIA as they look at, and I'm not trying to imply anything here, but even through the Russia and the KGB, understand they had some of the same argument. It would have been the same concerns internationally. I mean, seriously, if you're looking at an international argument, Krakow. Yes, Krakow. If I was the Poland recent air crash, the flight data recorder, about he'll go crazy. What was that? Or, interesting enough, it just so happens to be in Krakow, in Poland. They were supposedly actually stopping in a reevaluation argument for the use because they understand it. You would think Poland would be one of the firsts, considering what happened in Poland, Krakow, Auschwitz, i.e. the Hitler phone bridge effect. I mean, so if I should look at that for a moment as a reminder. So of the confusion of environmental general and proximity and telemetry of individuals and actual physical device use and impact on device, medical device use, and the variant degree of what would be perceived as either a physical act of war or a misconcluded argument against just the fact because technology is going to influence persons as. From what I understand, that is what was one of the major concerns during the Cold War. So, as I tried to surf through my own mind here as I'm trying to figure out how to say all this, is if I should cite Mr. Gorbachev, trust but verify, or that was Reagan, sorry, Ronald Nicholas Magnus. But between the two, during the Cold War, he recently made a statement about he was concerned about Cold War, another Cold War. He would absolutely be correct. Hillary Clinton would be probably, or would have been, one of the biggest what-if no-nos that should be taken into consideration. And I'm glad that she didn't get it. From what I have looked at her, she was directly affected by it. The reason that I mentioned that for the Navy SEALs, if I'm looking at Benghazi and Libya and so on, when it could come to the judgment impairment of leaving Stephen, oh shoot, I can't remember the guy's name, the ambassador, what was her impact of in a reactional point, if you're going to actually look into a psychological argument, if I should cite some of the work of Mr. Stephen Spisiak and the neuropsychiatric argument of her decision-making promise via, if I should cite a good friend of mine who does did some temperament research when it come to studying burnout amongst professionals. They call it vicarious trauma. About the carelessness point of response. It's the mental trauma, physical action of frustration trying to debate rationality. You add the ringing in the ears or any predisposed to trauma. You have been in fights and argument. You have the cases of the trying to figure out the level and degree of impact of PTSD and trauma, or in trauma, what is vicarious trauma of not being able or feeling helpless and not being able to actually deal with a situation. Doctors deal with that situation all the time. EMS, police officers, law enforcement, active duty militia per se, in the very degree, when these people argue at a point about how they harp on officers, yeah, they have one hell of a duty. I don't agree with a lot of stuff they do. But nonetheless, when you look at that type of point, and then you add the photoepileptic shock reactions, if I've read some of the material, when you look at firefighters or EMS and the tunnel vision psychology, the same physical reaction later post-fact when it comes to dealing with Pummit as it. Those are real concerns when you find different cases. And there was a case not too long ago, I read an argument about how the firefighters and the police department were arguing amongst themselves in a case, and the overbearing or inaccurate decision-making process and so on. The combination physical point, including photoepileptic response from the constant strobe lights. People can get that from in car accidents. Years later, you sit around or something like that, and you see that strobe effect. It's subconscious, from what I'm understanding, how the psychology works about it. That's why I cited Mr. Stephen Spisiak and some of his work when he came to dealing with trauma, from some of the stuff that I've read from his material and background. He would understand exactly what I'm talking about, and I think they should be taken to what he says the whole lot more, especially when it comes to the dental amalgam issue or the gold impact. If Hillary Clinton's argument of what if what happened with Benghazi and Libya is a point, especially when it came into her decision-making process, trying to deal with those in command and forward posts and so on, and government officials in specific locations. So, from what I understand from some of the material that I have read, I'll take this one step further. If I should cite the Kenya embassy bombing, some of that same mentality went into effect the same way. From what I understand, if some of the material that I have read with the FBI agent that they actually tried to screw in the middle of the argument, that was some of the debate of why the hell they didn't listen. So, if I should try to defend the FBI and some of what they're doing, especially if Mr. Croonery and the rest of them, as they have looked at the Hillary Clinton debate, trying to figure out what the hell happened and how the hell do we deal with it and how do we not overly react and wrongly and unjustifiably rebuke somebody. And that's a hell of an argument. So, in some regards, Bernie Sanders, you are literally doing more damage for your intelligence community, your law enforcement, and or even your doctors on a civilian level than you could ever imagine by continually ignoring the true representative republic for the office of which you hold, by allowing agencies and so on to rule by mob democracy and abuses of admin law. Again, I'll cite Mr. Philip Hamburg from In Primis, to try to put some sort of argument together with this. I can't think of anything else to say as I try to summarize this, but that's exactly what it is. And with the new FCC chairman getting ready to be picked in the middle of this argument, you guys need to take a very close look at this. And I will update my opinion on it and as I see it, for whatever it is. Good luck, Donald Trump. But just remember, people, just like Barack Obama, as much as I dislike him and glad to see him go, in the end, when the Senate doesn't take the authority that it has, who's that fault? Not the president.